So now that we have initial access on the host, we will further enumerate the host with several of the internal commands of Badger itself. When you type in help, you will see several different commands here. So what I've done for the course here is I have copied all of them in a text file and I've split them across various sections. So the ones that we will be taking a look at right now are the C4 profile demo, the ad hoc commands, file system interaction, and system enumeration. In the next video, we'll take a look at WMI enumeration and domain enumeration, ransomware emulation after that, memory evasion techniques, pivoting, privilege escalation, and a bit of automation using Qlik scripts. So going back to War Room, let me clear the screen. Now, before we delve into the internal commands of BruteRetail, if you remember something from one of the previous profiles that we created, we added a few commands of our own. For example, we added the DECLtest64 command, which is just a random name. We specified the path here for the DECLtest64. So when you do something like this, the server will read whatever is the object file within a given path. It will take this as the command name for this file to be executed. And whatever minimum command line arguments that you specified here, it will take that many arguments to be specified as minimum. So if I just go to my console and if I type DCL test, or let's say maybe I'll type help space DCL test, you can see that the minimum number of command line argument is 1. So if I just type this and hit enter, it will execute the object file. If I specify command line argument, this is an arg, it will read that up and execute that within the object file as well. This is an object file that you're seeing, which is getting executed. Now, similarly, there could be times when you want at least minimum 2 arguments to be specified. For example, in my case, there is a command called as set underscore malloc. So if I type help set underscore malloc, you can see that the minimum number of argument that it requires is 2. 1 and 2. So if I just type set underscore malloc, it will just print me the help on screen and it won't run the command. The reason for that is because I have specified the minimum number of argument here. Similarly, in the case of if a DECLtest64, if in the C4 profile, if I had added more than 1 here, it would not execute and it would only wait after more than 1 command line argument has been specified. Similar to this, you can also register C# executables, which is specified as seatbelt here. So if I execute whatever command is written here, which in my case is seatbelt, it should print me the help because I haven't specified any command line arguments. If I type seatbelt space, let's say user, it should enumerate the user and give me a response in return from the remote system. Perfect, as you can see. And it has successfully worked right now. Similarly, you can run other commands as well. For example, if I run something like monolog, the other monolog is also an external command, which means I have taken up an exe and specified that it's to run it as a command. And you can see it has given me the output, including patching of AMSI, EW event riot, and specifying which CLR it is currently using. Remember that this is different from sharp inline. Sharp inline executes within the badges process, whereas the register underscore p takes up the type over here, basically not exactly the type, my bad. It takes up the file and executes it into a remote process. If you want to execute it within BruteRetail itself or within the Badger itself, you'll have to use sharp inline, which we'll take a look at later on. Similar to this, you can also register your own reflective DLLs and execute them as well. In our case, for example, we have the box reflect command. Now, when I execute the box reflect command, before it is executed onto the remote host, specific strings from the reflective DLL can be removed so that there is lower or no detection. If you want to remove the MC header, it is removed by default, so you don't have to do anything over there. If you're running something else, in my case, for example, there's a function called as boxset, which gets stored within the DLL itself. So I'm erasing that by replacing the 5 length boxset string with a 5 length of hex strings of null bytes. Similarly, for this program cannot be run in DOS mode, I'm replacing that string with the exact same length of null bytes as well. So whenever this DLL gets executed into a remote process, these portions will be removed or replaced with null bytes, and then it will get executed. So if I type box reflect, and if I go to my BRVM01, as you can see, I'm getting box reflected. If I click OK, and it will just simply execute it complete over here. So this is how you can run your own external commands by integrating them with RootRetail. Now let's take a look at the other commands that we have, the ad hoc commands. I have already shown you CLS, which clears the screen. Remember that it only clears the screen here. If you go to server, if you go to logs, and if you go to any of your beacons that you have here, in my case, let's say it's B2, which is for the current date. If I right-click and take a look at B2, you would see all the commands that are executed from the start of time till date, which means everything gets stored in the logs. The screen that is only getting cleared is the one in front of you and nowhere else. Going on to the next command is the tasks command. The task command doesn't return anything unless there is a task which is in progress on running on the Badger itself. If you're running any long reflective DLL tasks into a remote process, you would see that up over here when you specify tasks over here. Else, it will just not return you anything. Now we can start interacting with the file system. The pwd command simply returns the current working directory. The cd command can navigate to different directories. So let's say I want to navigate to program data, and I have navigated over here. If I type ls, I should see the listing of C program data. As you can see, there's a file that I created, folder that I created earlier. Let me see if I can remove this with rmdir command. I won't be able to, I believe, because there's already a file in that folder. Error 145, this stands for get last error. So if you just quickly Google this error up in the Microsoft documentation, you would see what this error stands for. So if I just quickly start up, let's say Google Chrome, and if I search here for get last error 145, 145, the autocomplete. You can see directory is not empty and it won't be able to remove the directory now. So let's navigate to that directory, cdbgr test and ls, and see what contents are there. There's a file named as creds.csv, so I'll remove that file with the rm command. If you want to upload another file here, you can upload that with the upload command that you have. So let me see if I have a file here which I can upload. Let's say I want to upload maybe brute-reflect.dll, a file. So I can specify the full file path to upload space slash whatever the file name is, and enter. And if I type ls, you should be able to see the file that was uploaded. You can remove the file again over here by specifying rm space brute-reflect.dll. Similarly, if you want to download a specific file, you can download that using the download command, which we'll take a look at later on when we deal with some downloads as well. Now, if I go back and if I try to remove this directory now, since it's empty, we should be able to delete this directory, and there should be no directory anymore. Perfect. As you can see, no similar directories. Now, similar to your ls command, which not only takes a current path, it also takes up a remote path as well as an argument. C colon slash, it will show you information over there. Similarly, cd command can also accept your share path as well. Right now we don't have any, but you can normally navigate to other path as well. For example, if I type something like, let's say, let me show you an example. Let me type lsdr. As you can see, it lists all the mounted drives, but these are only the mounted drives, and you have to remember that these are not your drives which do not have a path and they're just mounted directly. They will be listed separately, and you can take a look at them using the netshares command, which are the shared drives without any specific, without necessarily having a specific label. And if you take a look at the help command of netshares, it can take up a remote system and it can take up an additional slash privs argument to check whether your current user has privilege on that shared directory. So if I type netshare space brdc01, which is my current domain controller, you can see all the shares that are there on my domain controller. And if I type slash privs, it will show me whether I have any access on that. Get last error 5 simply stands for access denied. If I just search for, let's say, 5, and let me just search for access denied. Yes, as you can see, error 5 stands for access denied because we don't have any permissions to that specific path. If I type ls slash slash brdc01 slash c dollar slash, again, I don't have any permission, so I would get an access denied. Similarly, if I try to do a cd on that specific path, I'll still get an access denied as well. We'll take a look at how we can manipulate the token, and we can use the token to move laterally later on, even if you don't have a process running under a specific user which has access on that remote system. So coming back, we have the cp command, which can copy files from one location to another. We have the mv path, which can move files from one system to another. The rm command that we've already seen, mkdir, rmdir, download and upload. Now let's take a look at some of the system enumeration command. And just one thing before I show you the system enumeration command, one thing you have to remember whenever you are dealing with RM or CP is that you will have to specify the full path and not just the folder name. So for example, let's say, let me upload the file here that I have. Let's say I upload this file named as creds.csv. And let's say I want to copy this to a specific directory that I have. Let's say I want to copy it to c:\user/public, I think. I'll get an error that I cannot copy it because the destination, get/error3, basically means it cannot find a full path over there because I have not specified the full path name. So you'll have to type creds.csv, and only then you will be able to copy it. You can see that in the current directory, that file still exists. That is creds.csv. If you want to move it to the remote directory, you'll have to probably remove the file that is there on the remote path and then copy that using the mv command. And now it will be totally moved from the current path to the remote path. As you can see, there is no file in the current directory anymore. Now the next command is the sleep command that we have. So you can perform a sleep by specifying a jitter and a percentage, a jitter percentage and sleep in seconds. Right now, as you can see, it's consistently connecting me back in every 1 second. If I type something like sleep space, let's say 10 space 40, what it will do is it will extract the 40% of 10 seconds, which comes to 4. It will add 4 to 10, and so it will subtract 4 from 10, which basically becomes 6. So it will sleep anywhere between your 6 seconds to 10 seconds that it has. So it's totally random, and you would be able to see it will totally connect in every random amount of seconds here. This can be either 0 or it can be more as well. And you can see B1 is connecting back, and we don't have B2 that frequently connecting back over here because it's connecting in every few random intervals. If I type, let's say, sleep 1, you would again see B2 consistently connecting back again once it comes back and takes up the argument after sleep. This way, you won't have to worry about your payload getting detected on the network ADR or net NDRs or network detection and response tools because your sleep is totally random and no one will be able to detect it. It will simply sleep between 10 plus 40 and will sleep between a random interval between 10 seconds and 14 seconds after that. Right now, I'll just keep it to sleep once that I can get quick responses for my video. The next command that we have is one of my favorite, which is crisis monitor. So crisis monitor is something that can monitor user change, power status, shutdown, and log off events. So if I type something like crisis monitor start, it will continuously monitor these events on the remote system. For example, if I disconnect or unplug my battery, you should be able to see over here that the battery was disconnected, as you can see. If I connect back again, you would see that the battery was connected again and the user session was logged. If I go here and if I, let's say, log in user at 123, I believe, my bad, I don't exactly remember the password. Yes, perfect. And if I go back, you would see user session unlocked here again, as you can see. And now if I, let's say, try to, let me just minimize this. Let me start up Remina pretty quickly. We close this portion. We start up Remina. And now I'll try to see if I can navigate or basically log into the system via any other user. And it should show up that a different user or remote session is being connected. Let me check what is the IP using the ipstats command. The ipstats command works similar to ipconfig, except that it uses internal API. And it shows you the DNS servers and every other information, including any virtual network adapters of your VPN connections as well. So this is currently my IP, I believe, 203.180. If I try to access that, as soon as I connect, by after entering the username and password, I should see remote session connected. Straight over admin at 123, and domain is brutretail.corp. As you can see, remote terminal connected, and it's waiting for me to exit it from over there. As soon as I type OK, you can see that I'm getting several notifications that my current console was disconnected because a new user connected it from remote. The user session was logged, console session was connected. That basically means that the new user's console session was connected and the remote terminal that I had was disconnected and the user session was unlocked. If I close this, and if I log back in again, you would again see similar notifications here. As you can see, console session disconnected, console session connected by the new user, and user session unlocked. I can stop crisis monitor using the stop command, and it would stop monitoring all these events henceforth. So this is something that can be really useful when you want to see if a new user has been connected, if your user, because that could be really helpful when you want to dump any specific passwords, or if a blue teamer connects, or if your system is shutting down for some XYZ reason, then you would know whether it shut down because of battery or whether someone else connected or something else exactly happened. The ID command simply prints the current user's ID. ID command. The uptime command simply prints the uptime of the current system. The idle time prints the number of, seconds or minutes. Yeah, it prints the number of minutes since when the system was inactive. Right now it's currently active because I am continuously using that VM, else it would have shown the number of minutes when it was inactive. The getPriv command will list the privileges of the current user. As you can see, I am not an administrator right now and I don't have any asterisks in front of my usernames, which simply means that I am an administrator. We've already seen the ipstats command. So let's take a look at the run command. The run command will simply run any specific command line, basically a command, and return an output from that command, whatever you're running. That can simply be any process. Don't run something like DIR. I've seen a lot of people asking me why DIR does not run, because DIR is an MS-DOS internal command of cmd.exe. It's not executable in itself. If you type something like whoami/all or whoami/privs, I believe, I don't exactly recall the command. Yeah, I think it was just whoami/all. Not privs, my bad. It lists you everything, and you can simply specify as much command line arguments as you want. You can also spoof the command line argument. If I type something like set_argument powershell.exe space, let's say echo $ps version table, and now if I run something like powershell.exe space sleep, maybe let's say for example 60 seconds, and now if I go to my system and if I take a look at maybe, let's say, Sysmon, for example, let me go to the event viewer here. I'm not sure I will be able to open up the event viewer without administrative privileges. Let me see. Yeah, I am able to run it. And I believe it's the Sysmon logs are in application. No, not application. I think it's in application/service logs. Probably take a few seconds to load up. Yeah, Microsoft, Windows, and there should be a Sysmon folder here. And if I take a look at the new processes created, let me search for PowerShell. And we have PowerShell here, which was created. Let me see if there is any other PowerShell that was created. Which was before, should be somewhere here. Yeah. As you can see, it tells us that the command line argument is PowerShell echo ps version table. But in reality, the command that we ran was sleep60 and nothing else. Similarly, if I type something like, let's say, get hyphen process, I should get an output of get hyphen process, but it should tell me in the Sysmon GUI that in reality, it is simply running echo ps version table, which is not really the case here. So if I just refresh this, go to the start, and let me say any processes created. As you can see, it still tells us the parent command line argument is PowerShell echo ps version table. Perfect. Now the next command after setting the argument is the get underscore argument, which can get you the current command line argument that you have set, and the clear underscore argument, which will clear both of them. You can take a look at all the processes that are running using the ps command, or by right-clicking your system and clicking on the process manager, which will open the process manager in a new window and list you all other information here about every processes. Over here, let's try to spoof the parent process ID right now. We have a notepad running on the remote system. So let's try to start notepad, but let us start under the parent process by setting the parent process as explorer. So if I type psgrep explorer, I can see the PID of explorer is 5764. So I'll type set underscore parent as 5764. Now I will run, let's say, who am I? And the command has been run successfully. So if I go back and if I take a look at who am I exactly? As you can see, we have who am I here. Let me check who was the parent process for who am I. As you can see, it's explorer. Explorer.exe executed who am I, whereas in reality, it was Badger because we spoofed the parent process ID right now. You can type get underscore parent to get the current process ID. And if you just don't want to set any process ID, you can simply go ahead and type the clear underscore parent command, which will erase whatever command line, whatever parent process ID you have set on the for the Badger to run as. The next command is the drivers command, which will list you all the current drivers loaded on the system, which can be sys file, DLL, or executables like NTOS kernel.exe. Remember that sys files can be loaded as exe and DLL as well, so just don't confuse yourself with .sys extensions. We have the dump clip command, which can dump any text that has been copied to the clipboard onto the remote system. As you can see, I copied clear underscore parent when I was over here. If I, let's say, copy all of this, for example, and if I, let me close this, if I go back to my rattled war room and if I type dump clip, I should get all of that, whatever details I copied over there. As you can see, everything that has been copied in the clipboard. We have the list underscore modules command, which can be really helpful when you're trying to enumerate the different DLLs loaded either in a current process or a remote process. If you want to see, let's say, this is a DLL loaded by an EDR. So there could be times when you might want to patch some specific functions or exported functions of the DLL. You can take a look using the export underscore list underscore exports command with the name of the DLL, and it will show you all the exported functions from that DLL, something that can be useful to find out the exported functions of something like ANSI.dll or something similar. In our case, however, I have added this command so that in the future, I can simply add more commands which can directly patch any DLL on the fly. This would be there in one of the future releases of BrewTotal. You can also list, let's say I type list underscore, let me just check what was the Process ID of, yeah. So the process ID of my Explorer was explorer.exe was 5764, if you remember. So if I type list underscore module space 5764, it gives me all the DLLs that are loaded in the given process, as you can see, with the full path. Now that we have that, let's go to the next command, which is the net command. Net command it works something like your net.exe, except that it does not call net.exe. It uses the internal APIs of your Windows to gather information about users. I can type net users, and it will list me all the users in the current system. If I type net users plus administrator, it will query the local system with whatever the username that I have provided. Sorry, my bad. It should be net user administrator and not net users administrator. And if, yeah, I got this error for my previous command where I typed net users. If I provide a DC name or a host name where I want to check for a user, I can specify that as well. For example, if I check my current user Vendetta, which is a domain user, which you can clearly see from here. If I type net user Vendetta space brdc01, which I know is the host name of my DC, it will give me the information about the user which is there in the domain. For further enumeration on the users, you can actually use LDAP Sentinel or LDAP query here directly in the below command line. For example, you can type something like object class equals to, let's say, user, and it will filter out all the users. It might take a bit of a while and list to all the users that are there within the current domain by running the LDAP query. So we'll go into this later on a bit deeper when we start dealing with the LDAP queries during our later part of the enumeration. That's basically the domain enumeration. But this is how you can gather different information on the user, either locally or remotely as well. The next command that we have is the rect command. The rect command takes up a specific, I'd say, hive, which can be HKLM, that is HK local machine, HKCU, or anything else that you want. Within that, you can specify what you want to enumerate. For example, let's say I want to enumerate maybe, let's say, security. So I'll type HKLM space security. It will give me a bit of information. Yeah, I don't have privileges, I believe. Let me check for software then. Software would contain services. Let me check for services actually, because I know that in the system directory there is key called as services, and within the, yeah, we have current control set here within which we will have services. And yeah, perfect. And if I check for services, for example, it will list me all the services that are there. And if I check for a specific service, for example, maybe let's say wsearch, for example, or type slash wsearch, it will list me all the keys and the dword values that are currently there, dword, qword, and every other values that is there within that specific directory. It will also list me the subkeys, as you can see over here as well, that is there within the wsearch portion, and you can further enumerate by specifying it in the command line argument. The rect command can only query for the time being. There is no modification of registry. I'll, however, be adding that later on. The next command that we have is the screenshot command, which can simply take up a screenshot and download that to the local machine. If I take a look at the downloads, you would see the current name is 4073, which should be this. So if I right click and not download, I will just right click and view. And you can see the screenshot from my remote system. You can download it by right clicking and downloading it. I canceled that earlier. And whatever files you download or upload, remember that there is a log for everything. So if you go to the upload log, you would see all the files that I have downloaded till now. If you take a right click and take a look at view the download logs, you would see all the screenshots and other files that I have downloaded along with the MD5 hash and everything. The next command is the sc query command, which can either query for services locally or remotely or only for a specific service. If I type sc query, it will list me all the services running on the current system. Service state 4 simply means that it's a manually started service and not a directory driver or something like that, similar to that of your Windows Presentation Foundation, which runs as a driver and more. If I type a host name, it can query the host as well. In my case, if I type brdc01, I won't be able to do that because I don't have a token or privilege to query that. If I type localhost, I will be able to query a host. And let's say I want to query this specific service, right? Let's say font cache 3.0.0.0 on my localhost. And instead of querying the whole services, because there can be a lot of services, you can see I will get only the information about that specific service as well. Then we have the contact harvester command. We'll take a look at this in a while on my other connection, other badger that I have. We have the set underscore kill date, get underscore kill date, exit underscore process command. So if I type get underscore kill date for this current system, you can see that I don't have any specific kill date set. If I type set underscore kill date, I can simply specify a kill date in RFC format. So if I type RFC, If I type, let's say the date, the current date is 26 September, 26 SEP space 2021, that stands for just 21. And the time, so my current time right now is simply 23:16. Yes, it's that late and I don't have a life. So that's why I'm still waking up at night. So if I type something like this and I type IST, because right now it's CXT, so by default, as soon as it's 23:17, it should automatically exit and kill my badger. And I think that is probably the last command. Then we have the exit underscore process and exit underscore help command. By the time it executes, let me show you the exit underscore help and exit underscore process and exit underscore thread. So the exit underscore thread command works differently from the process. A lot of times there could be a possibility that you might have injected your shellcode of the badger into a remote process. In such scenario, you would have to use the exit underscore thread so that you don't exit the whole process, unless you want to kill the whole process, in which case you can simply use exit underscore process as well. And as you can see, as soon as it is 23:17, I'm not getting any connections back anymore. Only B1 is connecting back because of the kill date that we had set earlier. There is no more badger running. And if I go back for my last command, that is contact harvester, I will probably have to hide a lot of output that I get over here because of the results that I would be getting. So the contact harvester command simply extracts whatever details are there from the global address book of Outlook and returns you all the contact information of every other person. Now, this can be useful whenever you're doing a phishing activity and quickly you want to extract more valid emails from after getting initial access so that you can send more phishing mails to other users, to valid users, you can get that. And as soon as I hit enter, you would see a lot of information over here. I will probably, you might be seeing a lot of redacted terminal here because of the same reason, because I have tons and tons of information which I cannot disclose for the time being. So yeah, that's it. So I think that would be it for this specific demo. And in the next series, we will be taking a look at WMI enumeration and then domain enumeration as well.